Augusta, Georgia, in the middle of the night. It was not like this the night before. A curfew was imposed, and the city was put to bed. It worked. There was no repeat of Monday night's violence. The contrast is stark. Just 24 hours ago, these streets were filled with rioters, looters, and burners. The National Guard was called in, more than 2,000 of them, and they took up arms in much of the business district and around several white neighborhoods. Police rode shotgun on the troubled city while city officials and black leaders tried to work out their differences. Tuesday afternoon and night were not without incident. Several fires were set, several crowds were dispersed, and several thousand persons held their breath. Negro entertainer James Brown flew into his hometown and went on television to tell black people to cool it.
We've got to respect each other, and we've got to sit down and talk about it. We're all human beings. I can't tell you to walk away from something that you believe in, and I can't tell them to walk away, but I can say we can all walk to the bargaining table and sit down and be men and human beings find something that, find a medium of reasoning where we can understand each other, because I think it's so important right now. I'm sure it's important, because anytime a few buildings, a little property is bad, but it's not when you start losing lives in another world. You know, you're going into combat, and we don't need combat here. You know, we just don't nobody want that here. Everybody's here is looking for the best out of it, and we're gonna get the worst out of it. Look, we got to stop it right away.
After talking to us, Brown left town, and Augusta blacks did cool it. Maybe Brown did do it. Maybe armed National Guardsmen did it. Or perhaps there was just nothing else they wanted to burn. It may be over, but several facts remain. 6 men are dead, 51 businesses have been burned, and the usual bustling city of Augusta has been shut down for a night. Jim Whipke, WSB News, Augusta.
I think Mr. Nixon is an effective leader of his party. Hope he would grant me the same. The question before us is, which point of view and which party do we want to lead the United States?
Largely made up of individuals who were involved in student government and other persons that were active in other organizations around the campus.
Sometimes it was 9 or so. The biggest it got was 15 members. They came together with their own leadership, and they started planning out different actions that could be used to confront the racial segregation and discrimination in Augusta.
I was involved in planning of it all. That's what the steering committee did. We had these projects.
My role as chair was basically to coordinate our interaction with community, because this activity was not just taking place on the Payne College campus. It was taking place in the community as well.
But that wasn't our big bang beginning. Our big bang beginning was the bus boycott.
Sweet, 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 sweet.
Because black folk would not be accommodated in the same way as whites at that event, we decided to ask Ray Charles not to perform, not to do it, not to continue to support these segregated practices. We didn't know where he was going to stay, we really didn't, but we knew there was one black motel in town, Charlie Reed's place, down in the east of the city, and that if he was going to stay in Augusta, he was likely going to be there. We didn't visit there. What we did, in fact, was send him a telegram, just assuming that that's where you got to be. You don't have to tell us that you're there. And we asked him not to perform. And the rest is history. He did.
Welcome back to Augusta, Ray. Good to see you.
Mr. Shaw, you know the night show is segregated? The dance floor is whites only. Negroes can't leave the balcony.
Well, that's how it is, man. You know, this is Georgia.
You think we don't know that? Negroes have been persecuted in this state every day.
Hey, look, man, ain't nothing I can do about that. I'm an entertainer, and we all got to play Jim Crow down here.
That's right. Now get out of here, boy.
It doesn't have to be that way. You can change things right here and now.
I'm sorry, son. Ain't nothing I can do.
You hear that, boy? The way things are, ain't nobody gonna change it. Now get your black ass out of here. Take that trash with you.
Hold on. He's right. He's right, Jeff. Get him on the bus.
You sure right?
Get him back on the bus.
Y'all heard him? Y'all heard, right? Back on the bus, everybody.
What?
Everybody back on
the bus.
Are you serious?
Ray. Get him on the bus.
What the hell is it?
I can't do nothing wrong.
Ray, you know me. I'm not going to lose money just because you suddenly got religion.
Nothing I can do, man.
You got a contract with me.
I know
you break it, I'm going to sue your ass.
And I win, Ray.
You got to do what you got to do.
Look, I win big.
You got to do what you got to do.
I own your ass, Ray.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Charles. You can be the first.
No, thank you, son. You're right. You're right.
You will never win Georgia again.
There was an organization called something like a Christian Student Conference annually, and had been meeting at Payne for some time.
Payne College was virtually the only place that this was happening, where black and white students came together for an annual conference, where white students lived in the dorm of black students at Payne. They ate in the same dining hall, that kind of thing.
And a group of us from Mercer had gone the year before. And it had nothing to do with desegregation or integration or race at all. It just happened to be an interracial meeting and had to do with, students with a Christian background and how they were dealing with life at that point in time. We went back to the meeting the next year, and that's when things were happening in 1960.
On that particular year, on that weekend, when we had many white students on campus, and all of us cooperatively doing kinds of services and so forth that one has during that week.
At Augusta, it was the first time that I had ever associated with black kids my age and my, we were all students, and it was all extremely exciting. Everybody there seemed so smart, so articulate, seemed to know what they were all doing.
Because of the events at the time, the desegregation efforts became a part of the weekend. And we learned that they were doing a demonstration, and we asked if we could participate.
We decided to incorporate those students in the demonstration. It was on a Saturday, I will not forget, to the consternation of their parents. By Saturday evening, I think many parents had come to pick up their kids and get them off campus.
We took part in the training, actually, and I was very impressed with this because we spent about 2 hours going over the do's and don'ts of these demonstrations.
The first thing we had to do was to prepare ourselves, and we did prepare ourselves to be nonviolent and be prepared to go to jail. And so and you did that before any of the demonstrations.
The one that sticks in my mind because of its pertinence to what happened later was that when we went downtown, we had nothing in our pockets.
You didn't need to have any objects on you that suggested that you could be a purveyor of violence. And you basically took a toothbrush maybe nothing much more than that.
They had very strict rules to go by, the nonviolent approach. of not responding to people, even if you were hit or spat on or whatever?
We would slap each other, spit on each other, call each other every kind of bitch and son of a bitch. And people that flared up, people that looked like they could not take it, that they would react and be violent, weren't allowed to go.
If individuals were identified who felt they could not adhere to the principles of nonviolence, those individuals were advised not to participate.
Right. So sometime they had to leave me at home.
Right.
If they felt they couldn't control themselves. Because the control of what we were doing was important to achieving our goals.
And the general purpose of nonviolence is to create the atmosphere in which social injustice can be removed and yet done in such a fashion that people will continue to live side by side as genuine neighbors.
We had the philosophical training, we had the practical role-playing training. They were extremely well organized. They knew what they were doing, they knew what they wanted us to do. There were people around the corner in cars ready to take us back. You know, everything seemed really organized.
Downtown Augusta was a very vibrant place. The weekends were one of the most active shopping times of the week.
Because it was Masters weekend, it was particularly crowded that day. There were no outlying shopping centers or anything like that back then, so everything was downtown.
H.L. Green's was a 5 and 10, a 5 and dime store on the corner of Broad Street, which was our major street downtown, and 9th Street.
We didn't have fast food restaurants. That's why drug stores were so important. That was essentially the fast food place to eat. Black people usually had to stand at the end of the counter and get their food and take it outside and eat it on the street.
And only white people could sit down and eat.
So what we were trying to do was break that barrier to say that if a Payne student can buy toothpaste over in this aisle, then they can sit on this counter and eat their hot dog.
And we would march from the campus to downtown Augusta if we were going to demonstrate and have sit-ins.
As we walk in, the lunch counter was on the left side of the building. Retail items were on tables.
At first, I didn't feel a lot of hostility, but we learned later that just around the corner from H.L. Green's was a barber shop where the Ku Klux Klan members hung out. And they were hanging out, and as soon as they figured out what we were doing, they started coming by and saying just really, really awful things.
And we walked in and sat at the counter, the lunch counter, and ordered a cup of coffee. And that's when things began to happen.
It was Cecil, a white man seated right beside the black leader of the Payne group. And they seemed to pick him out for some really hostile comments. In fact, of course, he's the one they were trying to stab.
Three or four of these guys hung around the end of the counter by the door, the entrance to the store. This guy kept walking back, and he would stop when he got to me, and he'd say, "We're going to get you. Later, we're going to take care of you." We got frightened.
You're 18 years old, and you're sitting on a stool in a dime store in Augusta, Georgia, and all this is going on. It's got to be an adrenaline rush. I mean, you've been in this girls' college in Milledgeville, Georgia, where not much ever happens, and suddenly here's this, you know.
Very frightened. Went through the one cup of coffee I was able to get and several cigarettes at the time because we were scared. So we waited another 30 minutes or so, seemed like 3 hours. And finally, one of the black students, and as I recall, it was Bill Diddley, came in and says, "We're going to take care of this. Don't worry about it." Said, "Just sit tight. I want you to get up and follow me out the door. When you get to the door, run."
It was an instance where the protesters, those whites who were very displeased with what we were doing, actually got out of control.
We got up and we walked to the entrance, and these guys who'd been waiting all moved just outside the door on the sidewalk, It was like there was a flank of them standing outside as we got there. We got to the door, and Bill Diddley jumped in front of them, blocking them from getting to us, and he said, run. And we didn't hesitate. We took off down the street. I looked back, and I saw Bill on the sidewalk rolling around. Something had happened to him. I didn't know what. We ran into a Learner's dress shop. I remember a little bit of embarrassment about running into a Learner's dress shop to hide.
We went in the ladies' dressing room, two women and two men, two girls and two boys, as we were called then. And I was thinking, gosh, if only my mother could see me now in a women's dressing room, a changing room with a couple of guys. Never mind what she might have said if I'd been in a sit-in. But
we leave and get back to Payne, and we're trying to find out what happened. Sometime later that evening, we get word that Bill Diddley was stabbed, that he was at University Hospital.
And we had to put a police guard out of his room to keep them from getting to him and hurting him more.
Those guys were looking for me, and Bill Diddley saved my life, and he almost lost his. He was stabbed with a knife that we assume later had some contamination on it. That's what we heard Saturday night, so that's where we were. The next morning, we learned that he was stable, doing a bit better.
Next morning, we went to a big Black Baptist church, and it was my first mass meeting. It was quite emotional.
They were doing a prayer service and having acknowledgments of what had happened the day before. And they asked me to speak for the Mercer students. And I remember they were thanking us for taking the risks that we did to do that. And I remember telling them that we had come into Augusta from out of town, and we were going out of Augusta back to Macon. But I'm sorry, I didn't expect this, but that they had to stay and live with these conditions. And in my book, they are the ones with the courage.
And being a school that was run basically by white folks, Payne was run by white folks, by the white Methodists, they could have shut off funding, and they didn't.
Dr. Calhoun was a very unique individual, again, of high principles. He never, ever tried to stop what we were doing, and in his public pronouncements, and in the things that he wrote, he always supported.
I just know that people are people, and they are good people, and they are bad people, and that has nothing to do with color at all.